This is an original poster from 1911 advertising the illusionist John Clempert, the man they could not hang. This poster was in three sections, ripped up, and we gave it a poster fix. Hi, this is Chris, and welcome to another installment of Posterfix Studio. Today we have a rare three-sheet poster from 1910 advertising the great illusionist showman John Clempert. He was a guy who could perform feats of strength. He could hang by his teeth. He could break out of chains like Houdini. In fact, Houdini sued him. Anyway, this poster being very old, it was also printed in three sheets, and each sheet was frayed and torn and ripped and had been through a lot over the years since 1910. So we gave it a poster fix. Watch. When I got this poster, it was in an unassuming envelope. It came through the mail. It's funny how something so valuable and rare can come in such an anonymous package. The packaging was kind of flimsy. You can never be too careful in how well you pack your posters before sending them to Posterfix. As you can see, this poster is folded, and I've got to gently open it up to see what is going on. The colors are good. The paper is very dry. It seems to have been stored in a dry environment all these decades, as I don't see any signs of moisture or staining from moisture. No mold. It's very dry. Very dry paper. I'm taking the three sheets and lining them up to see how it looks when it's all put into position, getting a sense of the overall design. And this section will go there. That was really the only big piece that was out of place. And it all seems to be there. I don't see any paper missing really, except for little bits in the fold intersections and at the edges mainly. What I like best about this poster is that it's full of small tableaus that show you the various presentations, acts, skits, tricks, and illusions that John Clempert used to perform. Every time we lean back a poster, we have to stretch a screen. Before we stretch the canvas, we have to take off the old staples and clean off the old, dry, crusty wheat paste residue that's on it. Now we are stretching the cotton canvas to the large stretcher screen. When a poster, a vintage poster, such as this Clempert poster, is considered rare, it is because there is only a limited number of them known to exist in the world by collectors and those who know. Bearing in mind that these kinds of posters were printed by the thousands, it stands to reason that there may be copies of them somewhere in storage in the world, unknown to anybody. Every once in a while, for example, a poster thought to be scarce appears in the market suddenly, and people say, "Gee, I've been looking for that poster for decades," and it creates a buzz. It goes into a big auction, and it sells for a lot of money. Posters can be discovered in a variety of places, odd places, weird places, places like in between your inner wall and outer wall of your old, old house. Yes, that's right, posters were sometimes used as insulation. People find them stored in deep basements of warehouses that belong to a printer, for example. You never know when something will crop up. In what condition they are in remains to be seen, and that can certainly vary. This John Clempert poster was left out of exposure to air and light, which is why it is not faded or stained. Although we use something similar to standard wallpaper wheat paste, it's actually a better grade of wheat paste, and we add an extra agent to it to neutralize the acids. Now I'm going to apply the wheat paste to the acid-free paper. The acid-free paper will then get mounted to the screen, and then the poster to that, and they will all dry together. I'm going to be reading from Derek Tate's 2018 book, The Great Illusionists, published in Great Britain. He's got some good passages on John Clempert. John Clempert was born in Russia in 1878 and was a professional wrestler before he decided to try his hand at being an escape artist. He was billed as the man they cannot hang and performed an illusion where he dropped 15 feet with a rope around his neck. His career began at Ferroni's Circus, where he appeared as a wrestler and performed feats of strength with his teeth. In 1903, while performing the hanging trick, he had an accident which ended his The Man That Cannot Hang career. The stunt was dangerous, and it seemed inevitable that his act would go wrong, as it did one night in Rochester when he injured his spine. While recovering in bed, he decided that he would perform an act similar to Houdini's, which included escaping from prison cells, handcuffs, and chains. The colors are good. The paper is very dry. It seems to have been stored in a dry environment all these decades, as I don't see any signs of moisture or staining from moisture. No mold. It's very dry. Very dry paper. The poster has been placed down onto a layer of wheat paste, which has been put onto the acid-free paper. Now we must saturate the poster with water to get it to help absorb the wheat paste and to get it to expand. Once the poster is expanded, we'll be able to begin rolling it out. I'm rolling out the poster to make sure that there are no air pockets between the paper of the poster and the acid-free paper. It also helps to push out the excess wheat paste and begins the flattening process. He joined Warren's American Circus in 1904 and toured India and the Far East, as well as making a few appearances in England. His show imitated that of Houdini's and included an exposé of his milk can escape. Variety acts were protected by copyright in England, and Houdini sued Clempert, who later apologized. Many think that Clempert disappeared from the scene after his feud with Houdini, but he continued his act with similar stunts and appeared all over the UK. From 1907 until 1914, Clempert regularly appeared on stages throughout Great Britain. He toured with his wife, Nellie. Before they met, Nellie had appeared on stage as one of half of the Carson sisters, a song and dance act. They had four children, including David Maurice Zelda, later an actress, and playwright Zelda Davies, and Aaron. The Manchester Courier and Lancashire General Advertiser of Wednesday, the 14th of April, 1909, reported, quote, John Clempert, an athlete who is this week appearing at a London music hall and claims to rival Houdini, the handcuff king, was prevented by police yesterday from diving from Tower Bridge for a wager. The Sheffield Independent of Thursday, the 15th of April, 1909, reported on Clempert's appearance in court. John Clempert, the Russian music hall artiste, who, it had been announced, would dive from Tower Bridge in manacles on Tuesday, but who was arrested by the police before he could do so, was brought before the Alderman House at the Mansion House Police Court yesterday on a charge of disorderly conduct. Mr. A.A. Strong defended. Subdivisional Inspector Hopkins of the Tower Bridge Police Station said that at 10 minutes past 1 on Tuesday afternoon, the defendant, John Clempert, who was in swimming costume with handcuffs and chains on him, drove in a cab onto the bridge, and witness suspecting that that was what was about to happen ran after the cab. The pavement was thronged with people, and several men shouted to the defendant to get out and do it from the other side. Witness called to the cabman to stop, and he did so. John Clempert asked, "What right have you to stop me?" And the witness replied, "I believe you are going to jump from the bridge, and you will not be allowed to." John Clempert became very excited and several times shouted, "Are you going to pinch me?" A large crowd gathered round, and eventually the defendant got out of the cab. He was asked to go away but refused to do so and was arrested for being disorderly by causing a crowd to assemble. Mr. Strong said that the defendant was a Russian and was accustomed to performing similar feats in his own country. He had made a wager to dive from the bridge. The alderman said he could not see what possible defense there was to charge of disorderly conduct. Quote, "You don't mean to suggest," he asked, "that a man can be permitted to go to Tower Bridge and amuse himself by jumping in the river with handcuffs?" Mr. Strong, quote, "He did nothing of the sort. I do not think at the moment he was stopped he had any intention of diving from the bridge. He is a foreigner and does not understand what a terrible crime it is in this country to cause a crowd to assemble." The defendant was bound over in 50 pounds to keep the peace for 6 months. In 1909, he wrote a book entitled Thrilling Episodes of John Clempert, the Shining Star of the Realms of Mystery. The Motherwell Times of Friday, the 29th of August, 1913, carried a report of one of his shows at the Hamilton Hippodrome. And their report of the show goes like this. "There are audiences of very gratifying numbers at the Hippodrome this week, the usual high-class variety and picture programs having been resumed for another season. The large and enthusiastic audience we saw there the other night augurs well for the success of this establishment for the present and future." A good many Motherwell people have long been in the habit of visiting the Hamilton Hippodrome, and it looks as if it is still retaining that favor. For we recognized a good percentage of Motherwellites among those present. Mr. Bostock heads his bill with a genuine sensational novelty, Mr. John Clempert's amazing act entitled Saved from a Living Death in Siberia. Mr. Clempert demonstrates in full view of the audience how he escaped from a Russian torture jacket, amongst his other marvelous feats in his escape from a submarine, a thing apparently beyond explanation. There is a welcome appearance of Mr. George Ray, an eccentric Scottish comedian who quite makes the audience roar with his "Ach Away" and other entertaining songs. Miss Lily Hill, aptly described as the Lancashire Nightingale, has an excellent reception, etc., etc., and all the other acts of that night are mentioned. And the book is marvelous. It has a lot of reviews of many different shows. As with all posters of this period, it is printed in lithography as opposed to offset printing. Lithography is when they take either a stone plate or a zinc plate and do the artwork in separate colors on separate plates, and then the artwork is combined when it's printed. The artist or lithographer does separate work on each plate that renders each color, and then when the colors are combined in the printing, it creates the illusion of full color. Posters in America were printed this way into the 1930s. In that decade, they switched to mechanical offset printing, where color separations were done mechanically using cameras and filters and dot screens. Voila! John Clempert is linen-backed, and that is a feat of strength. We're going to let this poster dry for a few days before we cut it down and touch it up. Hello, Posterfix. May I help you? You say you've got a circus poster you'd like to restore. Yes, I'm Chris, the owner.
My poster's really bad.
What size is it?
A big 3 sheet.
A 3 sheet. What's the condition?
Oh, it's got rips and tears.
Okay.
Can I send you pictures?
Yes, you can send me photos. Send me some photos of the poster at my email, chris@posterfix.com, and make sure to write in your email any issues you have about its condition that you want me to address, okay? And as soon as I get the email, I'll get back to you.
I'm highly recommended.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
I look forward to seeing your poster. Bye-bye. Don't go anywhere. Now we're going to show you the restoration. There's a lot of little ridges and peaks and creases, so the first thing we have to do is burnish the poster. That means to rub down the parts that are not flat. We have to do this before we do anything else. My wife is going into this poster with paper pulp to fill in the edge tears and the areas along the edge of the poster where the paper is missing. Once that is done, we will go over it with touching up. Archival colors. My wife Oki is using water reversible paints to touch up the areas of the poster that have had paper fills put in. I think in the last 32 years, I must have linen backed thousands of vintage circus posters. Watercolor pencils are our friend. We use them for the final adjustments, the fine tuning, and they work well for any needs of color enhancement which may be present in a faded poster. This poster is not faded, but there are plenty of other reasons to enjoy the benefits of watercolor pencils. As an artist, back in the day, I only worked in oils and acrylic paint. It wasn't until I got into poster restoration that I became comfortable with colored pencils. And there you have it. Another vintage poster that's gone through the miraculous process of linen backing. This is Chris. After 32 years of restoring vintage posters, I still enjoy bringing your vintage posters back to life. Thank you very much.